Forum on multifamily zoning. I'm Chris Gittens, member of the planning board, chair of the board this year. I have other members of the board here tonight, just in the department head, and Amy Lloyd. I am also planning director Tony Fields and assistant planner Catherine Perry. Go to the first chart. So we got two hours worth of material this evening. We'll put you to work, and hopefully you'll be glad we did. I'll talk for about a half an hour about the motivation for the multifamily zoning law and provide some background on the law itself, technical details, and what our obligation is. Then Jacinda will lead a working session, which will run about a little under an hour and a half. And that's broken up into smaller segments to keep things rolling along. There'll be some exercises to engage in, and I report out to the rest of the audience. And then with the remaining time, we can do some Q&A. And our goal is to wrap up by 9 p.m. this evening. So for background, I'm first going to talk about the motivation for the multifamily zoning law. I'll get into an overview of the law and the requirements for Bedford. I'll show some examples of multifamily housing in Bedford and surroundings. I talk to areas that are currently under consideration for recommendation by the planning board. And the way that this works is that the planning board will recommend areas of town to zone for by right multifamily use, and then town meeting will vote on that recommendation. I also talk.
That is how you are choosing to make this work. That is how you are choosing to make this work.
Correct. And then finally, we'll get into I'll share some of the focus group comments before we get into the working session. Legislature's motivation, now they recognize that Massachusetts is suffering from a housing shortage and an affordability problem. It's not an exaggeration to say that Massachusetts is exhibiting a housing crisis. Prices in Massachusetts, home prices and rents are among the fastest growing in the nation. The cost increases are putting financial pressures on individuals and families from the lower income up to the higher end of the income scale. It's not just individual and family financial pressure, lack of housing stock puts us at an economic disadvantage with respect to other states. And taking as an example, computer industry, Texas, Florida, North Carolina, Colorado, and Washington combined added about 160,000 jobs in that area over the past 3 years, where we lost about 2,000. So long story short, Massachusetts needs to add to its housing stock, both to provide better choices for folks who are living here now and to support a growing economy. High housing costs hurt people. I've lost count of the number of times I've heard residents say, my kids can't afford to live here, or I can't afford the downsize here in town. People are leaving Massachusetts. Since the start of COVID, we've lost about 110,000 residents. Housing costs being one of the motivations for folks to leave. It's too expensive, yeah. And I'll get into some of that. Yes.
I'm sorry, for childcare purposes, I thought this was an open forum and I didn't see public comments on there, so I wanted to encourage
you to do that. So we'll get into, during the working session, there'll be an opportunity for engagement, and then we've got a Q&A at the end.
So there isn't a chance for us to just do that to everybody, or just
everybody? No, the way that the tables will engage in a discussion and then report out their findings at the end of the sections within the working group. So who's leaving and why? Yeah, it is largely working age population, disproportionately people who live in our home county, Middlesex, also in Suffolk County, not coincidentally, two of the most expensive counties in Massachusetts. People in their mid-20s to mid-30s are dominating the outflow. Reasons cited include cost and quality of life, public transportation's not reliable, terrible traffic, and more affordable housing. This isn't something that popped up overnight. This is an issue which has been festering for multiple decades. And we've come to the point where the legislature has decided to take some actions to try to mitigate the problem. We can look at where housing production is at and has been for the past few decades, compare that to prior decades. From the 60s through the 80s, Massachusetts was producing 25 to 30,000 housing units per year, with a substantially smaller population than we have now. For the past 30 years or so, production's been barely half of what it was in the prior three decades. And not surprisingly, supply and demand being what it is, prices have increased accordingly. Before I segue into technical details of the law, a thought which I apologize that I couldn't commit to memory, so please indulge me. It's very easy to get drawn into the technical aspects of zoning, where we draw boundaries between residential and commercial districts, what height limits do we set on buildings, and I get drawn into it as a board member. As we get into the technical aspects of the law and what it requires of us, though, I ask that you keep in mind that what we're undertaking here is fundamentally about people and about building a stronger community. I think about the changes that we make to our zoning now and how those will play out in a generation or two. We'll be able to live here. Will they be able to walk to the grocery store or to the library? Will they be able to bike to school or to their favorite sandwich shop? I try to imagine a world where the T provides decent bus service. Now, will future residents be able to take the bus into the city? And the bigger picture question for me is, how can changes in our built environment make a positive difference in people's lives in the years to come? Now, we often think about how Bedford was in the past and how it is now, and this is an opportunity to imagine how it could be in years to come. So with that, talk about some of the specifics of the law itself. So this is the multifamily zoning law is section 3A of chapter 48 of Massachusetts general law. It is not a housing production requirement. It's a zoning requirement. That is that we allow multifamily housing to be built in some portions of town. In particulars, in the area that we designate, I need to allow for at least 15 units per acre. Can't introduce any age restrictions or other restrictions that would make housing unsuitable for families with children. We're required to designate at least 50 acres. We get to choose the location of the zone. It's not, we're not completely at liberty to do that. There are some rules that we need to comply with there, but we've got a lot of flexibility in what we do. Within those 50 acres, nothing has to be built, but property owners have to be allowed to build new housing. And we have to implement compliant zoning by the end of next year. So what does as of right and multifamily mean in this context? So as of right means that development can proceed without requiring a special permit or other discretionary reviews, such as a zoning board of appeals review. Wetlands, stormwater regulations, those still apply. We can maintain height limits and setback requirements as well, but we have to allow for multifamily housing to be built at a density of at least 15 units per acre. Proposals can still be subject to site plan review by the planning board. That's a review where we discuss how a project moves forward, not whether or not it does. Multifamily means three or more housing units on a single parcel of land, apartments or condos. Units don't have to be occupied by families, don't have to have a particular number of bedrooms in order to be compatible with a family living there. But we can't introduce restrictions which would make new construction incompatible with families living there. So the law applies essentially to all of Eastern Massachusetts. There are 177 MBTA communities, come in three flavors, rapid transit communities, commuter rail communities, and MBTA adjacent communities. We are an adjacent community. And per the law, we have to provision for the potential of 750 multifamily units. Go ahead. So the planning board's timeline, outreach and engagement in October and November. We'll call this November 35th. This month we will be drafting revisions to our bylaws and a warrant article with the intent of bringing it to annual town meeting in March. January will be public hearings. February will be an opportunity to make revisions in the draft that we create in the near future. And the state needs to review, and we need to implement those changes by the end of next year. So what the law is and what it is not. It's not a requirement to build new housing. It's not related to any state or federal affordable housing programs. It doesn't affect MBTA service. There is no eminent domain involved. It is a mandate to allow multifamily housing to be built by right in some parts of town. It does allow us flexibility to set building height limits and other zoning parameters. It does not allow us to require that buildings be renovated rather than replaced. That would be a decision of the property owner.
But can I ask a quick question?
Sure. And if we zoned an area for by right multifamily that currently has, if we added to the list of allowed uses multifamily housing, then the property owner would be at liberty to renovate accordingly.
And that would fall under the 10%
effect of being part of that. So we just have to add multifamily as an allowed use in that 50 acres or more. That is correct, at least 25, yep.
So, I'm really concerned about where you want to do this.
Mm-hmm.
My concern is trees.
Yep.
I serve on the tree committee. I'm also an active member of Mothers Out Front. This is just to give you an idea of where I stand. Looking forward, there's parcels up in the north of town where there's houses on large 1+ acres of land and other undeveloped property. And this is a nice canopy there, but realistically, within the 10 years, probably in the next 10 years, definitely in the next 20, all that's going to be gone. There's going to be a process where each of these parcels will come up for sale.
Mm-hmm.
And three things are going to happen. The developer is, or are likely to happen. Developer will come and rip down timber that comes
hold that thought. Let me get through this. Okay. In the working session, you're going to have a good opportunity to speak to that, and then to talk to the rest of the audience. All right, let's go to the next. I haven't started on this chart yet. All right, so Bedford has to own at least 50 acres for multifamily by right. If we break that into multiple areas, then at least one has to be at least 50% of the total area, and none of the areas can be less than 5 acres. Areas that are zoned for mixed-use developments don't count. We could add by right multifamily housing to the allowed uses in that area, but we can't count existing areas which are currently zoned for mixed use towards that 50 acres. Again, we need to allow at least 15 units per acre in our designated area. That's an average over the entire area. There may be individual parcels which are more or less. And for reference, Tony, you can check me on this. Avalon's about 20 units per acre. 54 Loomis Street is about 19. The Village at Taylor Pond is about 17. Patriot Place across from the old burial ground is about 17. And the residences above Blake Block are about 12. Quick question?
Just wanted to clarify that the places where there is existing dense multifamily housing don't count as is, but we can always include them and make them count. We would just have to zone them accordingly. So we don't have to exclude them. We don't have to ignore them. They're no different than any other lot that we could choose.
There are types of land that do not count towards acreage or our density per acre calculations. For example, wetlands, town-owned lands. We can't place age restrictions or restrictions that would make units unsuitable for families with children. Go ahead. So I'm thinking about what areas we recommend. The location of the area is going to affect the type of housing that gets built. A couple options include upzoning of existing residential districts and changing allowed uses in commercial and mixed-use areas. Some considerations for residential areas, if we change the zoning there. We could continue to maintain the height limits and setbacks so long as we're able to achieve an overall density of 17 units per acre or greater. For example, you could allow for a four-unit building on a 10,000 square foot lot, and lots near the center of town or around that 10,000 square feet. That would hit the 15 unit per acre threshold. Something to note is that by right would mean that construction on currently non-conforming lots, which is most of Residence C towards the center of town, would not be subject to ZBA review and approval. In commercial and mixed use areas, larger lots and commercial zones would allow for larger buildings. And if you think about addressing the housing shortage now, there's something to be said for that. Larger buildings might allow for elevators to be more viable and be helpful for people with mobility issues. A few examples. I mentioned Patriot Place, Loomis Street, and Village at Taylor Ponds a few moments ago. Different in scale and look. Patriot Place is basically on a single-family lot in the center of town. Loomis Street is a mixed-use area where housing is at a density of 19 units per acre. And the Village at Taylor Pond is a fairly large-scale development. You can also imagine smaller-scale multifamily housing. This is an example of a three-unit building. And if you look at an overhead view of the lot, if they built a unit over the garage, that would get the density up to about 15 units per acre. So that would be pretty close to consistent with the requirements of the law.
Can I ask a question? So that has to be just... Mm-hmm.
Yep. again, that's property owner's prerogative. It is private property. You know, state law allows the property owner to build single-family home if that is their inclination. An example of multifamily homes in West Concord that meet the 15 units per acre threshold, and this is off of Losbrook Road and Maple Street. And this looks, I haven't counted here, but you have multiple units in that building, which is an envelope, you know, comparable to some of the larger single family homes that we're seeing constructed in town recently. So location selection. Again, Bedford chooses the location of the zone subject to state approval. Planning board will make a recommendation. Town meeting is going to vote on it. Again, 50 acres total at a minimum. At least half, at least one of those parcels being 50% or more of the designated area. No area is smaller than 5 acres. Planning board is currently considering 4 areas. I'll show you maps in a moment. One around Depot Park and Loomis Street, another in the vicinity of Shawshane, at the Stop and Shop Plaza in the area across the street, area town center, and North Road, so between Wilson Park and the Route 4 225 split. We're not limited to those areas, and in all likelihood, in all likelihood, we'll consider a combination of those areas and you know, modify the boundaries, you know, relative to what you see on the maps this evening. All right, so Shawshane area, again, that's Stop and Shop Plaza across the street. Yeah, there is the Mead property. There is a commercial properties as you proceed down Great Road towards Lexington. Also, within the boundaries that we've drawn here for consideration, of course, I blanket on the name of the street. Alfred, thank you. Alfred Road, which is accessible off of Wiggins. Depot Loomis, that would include some of the current consideration. It includes a commercial area off of Railroad and the south side of Loomis Street. Town Center, we split that up into a north side and a south side, and then again, North Road between Wilson Park and the 4225 split. Actually, we can go back for just a sec. The thing to note that the total area of these parcels is much, much larger than we need to designate. So you'd expect that what our recommendation would be a modest subset of all the areas you see there. Thanks. Depot Park, Loomis Street area. Some characteristics, things to keep in mind. Favorables, it's on the bus route, near bike trails, pretty close to town center, and amenities there, not a long walk to JGMS or to the Whole Foods Plaza. The depot area is currently zoned commercial, and there's a mixed-use overlay there. Along the Loomis Street, lots are fairly small. So could imagine that that would favor small to mid-sized multifamily buildings. Along Loomis Street presently, it's single and two-family residential. One thing to note, what would the tax revenue implications be if we rezoned this to allow multifamily by right and it were redeveloped such that we lost the commercial or some of the commercial areas there. Overall, this is about 25 acres, touch more than that. The minimum is 50, So this could be a portion of the area we recommend, but it's insufficient in and of itself. With Shawsheen, Stop and Shop Plaza here, I drew a boundary to include the west side of Shawsheen Ave, the Mead property here. I cannot count the DPW building, town-owned land, can't be counted towards 50-acre total. I drew this boundary to imagining that a commercial would remain along Great Road. And then again, this is Alford Road commercial area. Overall, there's about, of this area, there are about 55 acres which meet state requirements. So you could, in principle, we could in principle recommend this entire area, and that would probably be sufficient to meet our 58-acre minimum requirement. So town center, here is, sorry, I'll try to orient here, Great Road, Bedford Marketplace, South Road, it's Hancock Street. So thought here, it's on the 62 bus route, on the narrow gauge and Minuteman bike trails. Again, you're pretty close to amenities. Smaller lots would favor smaller buildings, and imagine that the turnover there would be fairly gradual. Many of the lots are non-conforming. The minimum lot size in Residence C is 25,000 square feet. So if we were to rezone that, we'd have to come up with a workaround. A couple ways to do that. You could change the zoning so that to reduce the minimum lot size. Could also make it an overlay where multifamily housing would not be required to meet the minimum lot size, whereas single family would. It's maybe a little bit odd, but that's something that would be on the table. The overall area here is on the order of 100 acres. So again, it's far in excess of the 50-acre minimum. And then finally, that didn't come out at all. North Road, from Wilson Park to Route 4225. Yeah, this is the Bedford Motel here. So Bedford Farms in this area, Northside Convenience. This is Sullivan Tire, the VW dealership, Doyen's over there, and then Prince Street building there. So this is fairly close to retail amenities, near center of town, fairly near the bus. It's some older buildings, so potentially well suited for redevelopment. Part of the is in the historic district. Buildings themselves aren't particularly historic. I'm concerned if this were a rezone for multifamily and it were redeveloped as housing, what would happen to the existing businesses, and what would be the effect on our tax base. So before moving on, I have a few words about Great Road mixed-use district. You note that a number of those areas overlap with existing mixed-use sub-districts. So mixed-use is a mixture of residential and commercial uses on a single parcel. We have four of these mixed-use sub-districts: North Road, Town Center, Marketplace, and Shawsheen. Vertical mixed-use is allowed by right in all of those. So that would be commercial on the first floor and then housing above. Horizontal mixed-use, as complementary to vertical, you could have commercial and residential on the same level. Housing only is not currently an allowed use in those districts. You can have commercial, you can have mixed use, so we would need to change the zoning to allow housing only as an allowed use. And you can see section 22 of our bylaws for details. I promise I'm getting close to the end. Some areas which the board decided were less favorable than what we showed you there. The Wilburn Sportsman's Club parcel, far from schools, town center, and amenities. Not much for for public transit. There is a bus, 351, that goes by there. It doesn't get you to Alewife, and there's no public transit to town center. Expectation is that the Sportsman's Club is going to hang on to that parcel. So it'd be unlikely that any housing would be built there in the foreseeable future. Similar considerations for Crosby Drive. It's a long way from schools and town center. Weak public transit. I thought about Great Road from town center to Shawsheen. Yeah, it's on a best bus line. That's favorable. Not a lot of acres to count towards the 50-acre total. Bedford Gardens, again, far from schools, town center, and amenities. No public transportation. So this is a segue to the working session. So we are relying on community involvement to help us find the best way forward. Had about 30 attendees at each of our previous forums on the 16th and 29th of November. A lot of terrific observations and suggestions. So an opportunity for you all to weigh in this evening. Just a few comments from those focus groups before we move on to the working session. Shawsheen, folks see the vacancies in the plaza and note that it's overdue for a refresh. It's on the 62 bus route, easy access to 95-128. Commuting traffic would not go through town center. Most of it wouldn't, at least. Concern is that currently there are flooding issues, so perhaps be able to address those if the area were to be redeveloped. Some concern over potential loss of commercial space if housing only is allowed. There are wetlands issues. It's a bit of a hike to schools, and potential for large developments, that could be a fairly abrupt change to town. Some suggestions included extending the boundary we had originally drawn to include a portion of Shawsheen and or Elmbrook. Actually, the map that I showed did include that extension to include some of Shawsheen. With Depot Park Loomis, a short walk to town center, JGMS and Bedford High, it's on the bikeway. Concern over loss of commercial tax revenue if it redeveloped as housing only. Noted that that could be a good location for a future recreational field, athletic field. So if it were to be converted to housing, that would be a loss there. Traffic along South Road can be pretty horrendous. So there was concern expressed about what additional housing there would, how that would affect commute times. And potential changes of character to Loomis Street. For town center, folks commented that it seemed conducive to gradual change. I'm close to town center and to amenities there. Walking distance to JGMS and Bedford High. On the bus route, near bike paths, no commercial spaces to be affected. Replacement of older but not technically historic homes was raised as a concern. And was also comment about potential additional traffic around commute times. For North Road, comments that it's an area which is due for a refresh, that new housing in the vicinity could help support the existing businesses there. Short walk to Bedford High, library in St. Michael's, and that there is some potential for infill housing. There was not a lot of enthusiasm in the prior forums for the North Road area, and traffic being identified as a major negative, and that additional housing could well make it worse. While it is close to Bedford High and the library in St. Michael's, the area in general isn't tremendously walkable, and there's potential for loss of commercial space.
I have a comment on the North Road area. The Select Board has approved an over 600 person development on Carlisle Road. Apparently start going in the next year or two. That's gonna make the traffic on 225 right through that section a multitude worse than
hold that thought. You're going to have the opportunity to chime in as soon as I get through. Well,
I wanted to chime in now.
All right. Let me get through this, and let's move on to the working session, and y'all can engage there. Ah, so at this point, I'm going to hand it over to Jacinda. I thank you for your patience. Yep. Yes. So I'll answer that and then hand off to Jacinda. So we've got about 5,500 housing units at present. We have to allow for potential 750. How many get built and over what time frame?
It's up to 15% increase.
Correct.
Population of
Bedford. Quick questions, and then let's transition over to the Robin, I saw you first. So if we just add to the list of things that the property owner could do with the land.
So it could be business owned or it could be
multifamily. Yeah, if they decided they wanted to build a new, you're going to have a list of allowed uses for that space.
Which suddenly makes it much more appealing to sell it to somebody who wants it.
Yeah. I guess I'm just trying to understand, you're not hurting the businesses if you zone it this way because they can stay that way.
No, there's no, all it does is add to the allowed uses.
Okay.
Property owners can do absolutely nothing if that is their inclination. Yeah, I'd like us to proceed to the working session, and we'll.
Will you answer though why we're not considering some of these, or when we could consider them?
As we get through the working session, yes. I'm not going to do that here because I want to stick to the agenda that we've got.
Okay, but we still want to know though.
Sure.
If you guys have the answers, so will you answer those?
Sure, I'm going to answer those, but I'm not going to do it now. I'm going to let the working session start up, and as we go through that, I think some of your questions will be answered there. If they're not, then we'll speak to those.
This is quick.
All right. Wait a second. I think Steve had it.
So what's your best estimate of we get 70 units, how many schools over that?
About a half student per unit would be the number based on long-term trends. So 375 would be if every unit were built. No, it's that half student per unit that has held up for several decades.
So you keep talking about an assumption that there will be slow change in built up areas. There's enormous pressure on the housing market. We're here because there's a crisis. I think that as soon as you make the changes available, as soon as a house is brought on the market, the max numbers of units are going to be put in. This is a tremendous profit opportunity.
I'm going to hand this over to Jacinda. If we don't get answers to that during the working session, I will speak to that at the end.
Okay. I can talk with Ben intercom better. All right. Okay. Thank you for your patience. That was a lot of information. What we want to do now is really get your input, and we've set up the table specifically so that we can engage as many people in a meaningful way as possible in a short amount of time. So if you don't mind, we'll just go in on it. And if you follow my lead, there's opportunities to ask lots of questions as we do the breakouts. But and additionally, at the end of the breakout sessions, we have 15 minutes at the end of this thing to just free for all question and answers to your heart's content. Okay, and we'll stay longer if you want. First off, we want to do a quick warm-up exercise, and we want to break into your tables and introduce yourself to each other at the table. First names, and tell everybody at your table what's your favorite thing about Bedford. And while you're doing that, in that 5 minutes, you need to decide on who your team leader, your table leader is gonna be, who's gonna be recording and reporting back to the room after the 5 minutes is over. And there's only one rule, no elected officials are allowed to be the team leaders. So other than that, you can pick whoever you want. So on your marks, get set, go. All right, 30 seconds to wrap up this one. All right, does everybody know everybody yet? Let's start with table one. Table one, do you have a leader? We got Jim is going to be the leader. Tell us about what your group likes about Bedford, Jim.
Rural space, town center.
Mic a little closer so everybody can hear.
Rural space, town center. I'm sorry, small town feel was mentioned by a couple of people. And the library. That's right. Thank you.
Thank you. Table two.
We said small town feel, but with services, good fiscal management, lots of community involvement. And the people at this table have all been here 29 years plus. So I think that was great.
All right. Thank you. Table three. Right now, we'll go to table four since Chris is there.
Thank you. We had similar aspects that people enjoyed here. The quality of life, the small town came up multiple times from people, the closeness with your neighbors and the community, the opportunities for our children and families, things like school sports and good schools came up, but definitely small town and community and the closeness and neighbors came up multiple times.
Thank you.
We have a lot of long timers here also, so.
Table three. Over here.
All right, nothing new here. So we said the supportive schools and the small town feel.
All right. Table five.
Not much new. Great schools, amenities, small town feel, small town government, great biking, and community stuff that we have.
Excellent. And last but not least, table number six.
A lot of this was already mentioned. We have a small town feel, although there is a matter of perspective where some of us came from really small towns. And Bedford is a commuter town and can have a little bit of a bigger feel in places. People like the lot sizes, the feel of having some space, the quiet commutability with the location close to 3, close to 128, the schools and other town services, the DPW was mentioned, shout out there, and community feel and feel of togetherness in the community.
Awesome. Great. All right. Now we're going to do another quick one. Our first question, we're going to take 5 minutes to, before we dig into what we want to do, let's seriously consider how or why we want to do it. So what are our desires for Bedford? What is our vision for Bedford? Knowing that change is going to happen, whether we want to it or not, what are our desires and our vision for our town in the long term? Not next year, but like, you know, 5, 10, 20, 30, or more years. Okay, 5 more minutes. Go.
I
30 more seconds. All right, we ready to report back? We're going to start with table five this time.
Okay. Let's see. The goals.
Can you talk a little louder so everybody can hear?
The three goals we came up with was keep the qualities of the schools. Keep the qualities of the schools. And as the years go by, to keep or make Bedford more walkable and more bikeable. Emphasize that, and then a nebulous one of maintain the character of the town.
Okay, thank you. Table six.
We said that it's really good as it is. People are here for a reason. Then we reframed the question as if you knew it was going to change somehow, what change would you be okay with? And we really focused on the Stop and Shop Plaza area, thinking that there's a model in East Woburn where they've converted a strip of mixed use and they have a great condo development on one end and then Market Basket and so on and so forth on the other end. And it's one large contained area close to the highway, so it doesn't really impact traffic flow. That seemed like a change that we would be okay with.
Thank you. Table four.
We wanted to keep the same small town feel. We don't want to lose what we love about the town, maintain the quality of life. Things such as investing in the schools, keeping our diverse community where everyone's welcome, but at the same time, not getting too big too fast so that we maintain the other values.
Great. Table two.
We talked a lot about the systems need to support the number of residents. So if one grows, the systems need to grow in support of that. We also talked a lot about commercial businesses, and we often say that's a good thing, right? Tax revenue, services that they provide, jobs, infrastructure, all needs to be in concert with that. And one of the other points that was made is that we need to be very strategic. So we talked about Crosby Drive and that very intentional development. So when we first moved to town, it was this great example that we often gave. So we want to be really thoughtful as we put together these plans.
Awesome. Those are some great, great suggestions. Table one.
So the things that people said that they wanted were have it be easier to get around on town by foot or bike, be able to have other choices than one person in a car trips, a strong desire to slow down, if not stop, development, preserve our green space, increase more local home ownership, try to discourage remote investors, have more dynamic housing programs, set-asides for affordability and other helps to help people get situated. There was a desire for just more economic diversity, more different kinds of people able to live here.
Great, thank you. And table three.
All right, we had three desires. The first one is we really like nature, so keep as many of the trees and the natural bike paths as we possibly can. Number two was to refresh the town center, try to get rid of some of the empty storefronts and put in more events that draw people down into the center of town to do things. And number three was reduce the traffic.
Great goals. All right, thank you very much. Okay, now we're going to get into the crux of the issue. And Chris, maybe you could help just the map, one map at each table to, of this four. So we're going to hand out a map, and on each of your tables, you have two kinds of Lego bricks. You have 2x8s and 2x2s. The exercise you're going to have is for the next 15 or so minutes. Look at this map, place Legos where you think it would be best put the density that we're needing to add to town. So like I said, the 2x8s represent 100 units, and the 2x2s represent 25 units. The pink areas are highlighted are the ones that Chris talked about that we've been kind of focusing on for the last two workshops, but you can put them wherever you want. And at the end of the 15 minutes, we're going to ask you to showcase what your team's come up with and give some rationale for it as well. Also, if you have any questions, if your table has questions, raise your hand, and a planning board member or staff person will come over and answer the questions for you as you're working through this.
Can the planning board, can we implement any type of growth restriction? Once this goes in, could we say like one per year, one per decade? It's just a flat, there's no by right period out of the gate.
You see my argument.
Built out, could we then say, all right, we're going to change our zoning back? Those are the 50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Doesn't save a lot of take away something.
Well, the requirement
because we still met the 15 and 15. Yeah. So
they're not going to program to check on how many.
So yeah, hypothetically that could. I won't tell. I'll tell him it's not. No.
That's important, right?
So there are arguments against including Carlisle Road development. One, it's far from bus route. Not really. Part of this, enable creation of additional housing. Yeah, preferably in a way that doesn't require people to drive if they want to get anywhere. The density is under 15, so it would have to be made up with higher density elsewhere. It's about 70 total, about 55 of which would go towards the states. So. They would be sold individually if it's one owner.
Access by Wiggins.
Yes. Now, if an owner acquired both of these lots, they would be able to create an access. Well, he would for this area to get access to Great Zone.
Built out. Well, how does that feel?
Well, it's like that. it a Bedford problem? Housing shortage and that's all I'm asking.
Every community tries to do their part to help alleviate the problem. I look at the stuff in the streets. They've been decades. This is not a
when you have your Legos fairly where you want them, replace your Legos with the dots on your table so that we can take them back and use this information later. So where you have a green, where you have the big ones, put a dot represents each Lego. So you have four dots in that one, you have four green dots and one yellow, and well, actually you have five dots. Got it? So that's so that we can take it back after the meeting's over and know where you're interested in. So did everybody hear that? When you're... You still have five more minutes, but so...
Very good. right now it's zoned for that. If the current owners wanted to sell, the new owners could come in and do exactly that. But if they could. The way that the state rules work, municipalities have a minimum number of acres and a minimum number of units that they have to designate. So for towns like...
All right, we need to wrap it up. Has everybody got replaced their Legos with dots so that we can look at it later as a planning board to take your input? And besides dots, put your table number on your paper so we know what table you are. All right. Okay, we're going to start with table two. We'll start around in the back of the room. This is a team effort. We need team people to hold the paper up and then one person to explain it. Christina?
Okay, so we are table two, and I think we came to this conclusion pretty quickly. We centered our development around the Great Road Shopping Center, and we have 600 units there. We felt that we liked the idea about mitigating some of the drainage issues, hopefully with some environmental plantings, maybe reduction of paved areas, so some benefits to possible development, to that potential. And then we also put some other units, I'll kind of duck down. In the yellow dots, you can see, how many units are there? 150 units there in the yellow dots, somewhere along Loomis Street, and then other in the depot area as well.
Thank you, table two. Table one, you ready to report?
Thank you. Yes, we stole from them. Basically, okay. Oh yeah, there we go. We had six of the large units in the Great Road Shopping Center in Shawshin. We allowed for a couple of smaller units just outside of the area as the pink line, because we said we had some discretion. And most of the rest of them were, putting some small buildings in the Depot Square and Loomis Street area, although people expressed a fondness for Loomis Street as it was. So there were sacrifices were made.
All right, thank you. Table three, you guys ready?
All right, so same as everybody. We put a lot of green down in the Shawshin area. We gave, let's see if I can do how many things I can hold. All right, so we replaced the hotel. Bedford Plaza Hotel. This screen doesn't have great access to the bus, but it has great access to Steve's Pizza, which we thought was critical. So put a bunch there. And the House of Beef, yep. We put some more housing down in the Alfred side, and then 200 on top of Stop and Shop. And since I'm worried that they'll then sell the Stop and Shop and put in houses only, and we're no longer allowed to specify mixed housing, we really gerrymandered this district, so it would be impossible to build straight housing there. There's 5 acres, but not contiguous enough, so you're kind of forced into mixed use. And then another 100 over at the edge of the middle school here, where the flooding is, so that if somebody built there, they'd have to fix the flooding. Another 100 over here where they're already building a new big building. And then we took out the other hotel as well and put in 50 units there.
Thank you. Table four, when you guys ready?
Just some of the things that impacted our decisions were worrying about commercial and the tax base impact, worrying about growing too fast. We were looking for slower growth to adapt for resources. So we want to keep the town character. I'm actually going to pass it to Jeff so that he could talk about the Great Road Shopping Center.
So we didn't want to completely wipe out the commercial uses over here, so we didn't focus all of it there. We wanted to spread it out throughout the town to some degree. There are lots where you can take advantage of the size of a lot and just kind of not just put everything in one spot. So we've spread it out with smaller 25 units up in the North Center and the North Road and the South Center.
Table six.
I think to spare you all and save some time, we don't really need to show the map. There is a theme emerging. It is virtually identical to several other maps that we've seen.
You're the first one with
some scattered additional housing added to North Road area.
Okay.
Focus on Great Road Shopping Center, Stop and Shop Plaza, mixed use. Build on it.
Thank you. And table five.
Same theme, same generic theme. Shawshin, there was a discussion about whether or not to extend the boundary down Pine Street, because some people think it's a boon, some people think it's not. So that was a discussion, but same thing. And then also do Loomis, somehow trying to mitigate slow growth with getting the job done.
All right, thank you. Okay, now we're going to keep those maps, and we're going to do one more breakout. And This one's going to be a little different. So given that you kind of schemed out where you think it would be best, we're going to give you some more pieces to the puzzle that we need to consider as a town when we actually write the zoning for this. We can't just say, this is where we're going to do it. We have to make sure it's a reality. And some things in the zoning code may or may not need to change, or we may or may not want to change them. So some things that we want to think about are the buildable lot areas, setbacks, heights, and parking. So like I said, we're going to go through a high-level understanding, and we just want your high-level thoughts back tonight around directions you all might be comfortable with going. So right now, we have current dimensional requirements for everything in town. It's very, 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 very specific. We have height limits at the far right. You can see the max height limit is 3 stories for residential everywhere, 35 feet. Just a little bit more in the different kinds of industrial and commercial zones. We have setbacks for, and we have lot sizes that we highly control. And we need to think about if these numbers are going to be correct, if we're going to do some zoning in one place or the other to add capacity that we're looking for. Next. This is the dimensional stuff specifically for the Great Road business districts. Next, I'm going to hand you a sheet out after this that has all these numbers on it. Go ahead, Chris. It should be right there. Where's the height on this? I don't see the heights.
It about 35, I believe.
Yeah, it's. It does. It does look tall, but yeah. right. Next slide. So when we're talking about these things, what does it mean when we're talking about all these numbers instead of just numbers on a chart? So every lot has a part. Your parcel has a size. It's got a. It's got 2 dimensions on it, and within that, we control the height of the building. We control the setbacks from the front of the street to the front of the house, from the side of the street, from the side of the house to the property line on both sides, as well as the rear. We also control how much parking you have to have or how much parking you may be allowed to have, depending on where. So we can play with these variables and get a lot of different capacity options. And we need to think about if we're going to do, for instance, if you're concerned with, a lot of people put more multifamily housing in the Shawshin area. If we do that, it has to be residential only. If we do that, we might lose some of our commercials that we want. And then if we do that, maybe there's a way we can try to incentivize developers by giving them more height allowance to have both mixed use and the residential only. So if we're comfortable with a higher height there, we could actually create a greater possibility that a developer would come in and want to choose the mixed use option. This is not anything for town. This is just an example of it. Yeah.
So are we expected to do this without a program?
No. So we're just going to go. So I just want you to think about, like, visually, not even, but like some of the things in the infill area. So in the residential infill area in particular, where we have single family only, we have that height limit of 35. We have setbacks, front yard setbacks require 35 feet. We require 2 spaces of parking per dwelling. So if we all of a sudden say, okay, on this single family lot, you can do 4. Are we going to allow the building to be closer to the street? Are we going to allow it to be taller? Are we going to say you don't need as much parking? What are all of your thoughts around that? What and your comfort zone around that? Nick.
A bit of a tangent, but did we ever
Unfortunately, no. We're not able to take advantage of that.
Yeah, so if we want to maintain any mixed use in some of these areas, like we showed on the with the brown map of the business districts that are now mixed use, if we want those to remain mixed use, and we're going to say that's an option for this multi-family housing, we could, like Lexington did, give an incentive option where a developer could have a higher height allowance if they came in and did both instead of just the one, so that we could maintain our commercial and get the residential on that spot, if that's where everybody wants it. Christine. Or no, I'm sorry, I missed you. So the timing of these things is really interesting, and Chris alluded to it in his deck. So if we're going to do a parcel, rezone a parcel to multifamily like the Stop and Shop Plaza, it's a big property, and it's going to be a lot of units there. People are putting 400 whatever units right there, right? So if that happens, that's going to happen all at once, and we're going to have 400 more units. There's not much you can do about that. The other way you can do it is by allowing this gentle density infill development in the single family only, where over time we see as property changes over, or if housing gets kind of too far gone because it's not being kept up, it has the potential now, instead of doing a single family, it can do multifamily, and that would be the developer's choice. And to your question, you know, how do we know if it's going to happen too fast or too slow? We don't know for sure, but we can use guidelines like in the last few years. I think about 5 years ago, we put ADUs, accessory dwelling units, as a detached option on our books in Bedford. We have one, and we're having our second one come before the planning board next week. Okay. Yep. So and we put in 2 years ago or last year, we did by right two family zoning allowed everywhere on a conforming lot in town. That's 50% of the housing in town. We haven't seen anything. So what you see is it's the same rate as the natural turnover of the tear downs to single families now, but we're be giving more options for those teardowns to be a higher occupancy.
So, no, we could not place restrictions on growth rate.
And we won't be able to pivot either.
That's correct.
Molly?
To really answer your question, if we don't like what we're seeing, you have to go to a new town meeting, pass a new bylaw. Good luck. Yeah.
It would need to be compliant with the state law.
Molly? So,
you need to think a little bit.
Yeah.
Commercial real estate needs to be part of the solution. Mayor Wu, I am not in a. It turns out, great minds think alike. Mayor Wu had the same idea. She launched a program this year to get commercial real estate owners to convert their properties into residential. This is something we need to keep in mind.
Right. But we should also add, though, it's very place specific. So if we're gonna put in 500 new units in the Shawshing area, what's gonna support it? Are we gonna if there's no commercial there, that means they're all gonna get in their cars or hopefully on a bus and go someplace for their shopping.
Let's fill the commercial space that's on Loomis right now. There's empty commercial space.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Empty commercial space.
Yeah.
And so, it's...
It's not a...
It's there, it just needs to be used.
Yeah. Right. So, one more question, and then I want to do the breakout. That's a good question. How many units are in Taylor Pond total at 17 units per acre? 200. Avalon has 134 units. 139. So think Avalon times four, if you want 400. Right. And that's why maybe you need to consider your map a little bit more and think about the balance that you want. Do you want that high-rise thing that's satisfying most of the requirement, or would you rather spread it out in a bigger residential area where you can do stuff like a 3 to 4 unit capacity on 1,200 to 20,000 square feet.
But we can put a limit on the size of each building. Right. Yeah. Not just the height, but the number of units
for
building. We don't have to allow for one giant 600 unit building.
No. Yeah. So let's just talk about this at the tables for a couple minutes. I put in a sheet on each table that was the number charts that I showed you. And raise your hand, and we'll come around and talk to you. But the idea is to kind of thoughtfully think about the realities behind where you placed your dots, and think maybe a second time if that's really where you want, given maybe that you know a little bit more now about the constraints that we're talking about that are in baked low level into the zoning code. Oh, wait, actually, before we break out, I'm sorry, can you go flip back to the other deck? I want to show you another big thing besides the height and the setbacks is the parking. And what you need to think about is what we have for rules on our books right now for parking. The more parking you require, the less buildable space you have for the actual building. Next slide. Here's an this is what we currently require: 2 parking spaces per dwelling unit in town. Okay, so if you're going to take a single family, that's 2 units, but if you're going to let a single family become a 4 unit, that's 8. Do you really want to have 8 parking spots in every parcel? Maybe we want to change that number. And then it's 1.5 for the multi-use areas. The next slide, please. This is an example of what you can see. An average 2-bedroom apartment being built today in these apartment complexes, 600 to 800 square feet, is the same size as it takes 2 parking spots. So you're really crippling the amount of housing capacity you can have every time you insist on parking limits. Next one. That's a similar slide. Next one. And then, so think about, in addition to parking, the height and setback allowances, do we want to do parking minimums, maximums? Do we need them at all? And do we want to consider the option of on-street parking? It's not under the planning board's purview. It's under the select board's purview. But right now, we can't park on our streets. But if we could, we wouldn't need to find extra land for parking. Okay, now you can talk.
Size, you could put up a 4-plex, and that would be, that's so, and the rate of, and it would be a gradual rate of change. I really don't imagine that folks would, all of a sudden, everyone would sell, and you would have turnover as there is now. But multifamily building would be an option in addition to replacing a single family home with a new one.
Well, lucky for you, I lived on South Road for 18 years, and I can tell you exactly what happens. It isn't a matter of changing hands. It's a matter of landlords down this way. They're like, they kick out their tenants, they rip down the little duplex, two 600 square foot units, and they put in McDuplexes. And this is the, and here's lots. Actually, this area, not so much. This is more owner occupied. Look, here's the thing, when you have these little lots, the only way to get anything more than two units in it is to go to the lot line. And then, how are you gonna do that?
So Batman, right now we have setbacks, you know, we have height limits.
One at a time.
So we have setbacks, we have height limits, and we don't need to change those. Assistant Planner Perry ran both these lots through the state's compliance model. And if you waive the current minimum lot size requirement, but keep the setbacks, keep the height limits, you can hit the requirements by designating these areas as our multifamily by right.
Are they all going to be that small, 75 square feet?
That would be pretty sketchy to try to put in size restrictions. Yeah. If you do that, then you're in the realm of the state saying, no, you can't put in.
But you're effectively doing that. If you have setbacks and the lot and the buildable footprint is only so big and it only goes so high, there's only so much, many apples that go in that paper bag.
And then again, ran the exercise and fourplexes on these 10,000 square foot lots.
And what is set? What would the square footage
for that? So you would have to.
And parking.
You'll imagine a 4,000.
Everybody wants a small town feel. You've got to move it here, but you can meet with Bedford once it was somewhat here.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
Well, let's be fair. 50-something years ago, there was farm land and much of this stuff. So it's changed a lot. And it's going to continue changing. And I see what they're saying about all the problems when you get rid of the I don't envision people not being allowed to have a car. I don't know how we get around that, and I don't envision people having to be forced into tiny little spaces to live in. That those two things.
But putting size limits on the units would probably not be compliant with it.
Right, and so if as long as what you're saying is we were keeping the height, we're keeping the setbacks, and as long as that doesn't automatically mean removing itself.
So if the property owner looked at that and said, there's no way that I can put in a building with four units and sell them in the market, pretty much anything goes. Yeah. But if,
you're just putting additional options on the table. If the owner says, I want to replace a single family home with another single family home, go right ahead.
Well, here's the thing, there's a lawyer who seems to get exactly what she wants.
So I will tell you that the vast majority of proposals that come into the board, people know what they're doing. They've researched our laws, and they know what complies and what doesn't.
This person always seems to get an exception.
What are you referring to?
She took down trees over here because this developer wanted to build, and he got permission to build with the foundation directly on the lot line. He crossed over into town property and got permission to take down town trees.
So town, as the owner of that land, had two public hearings, and as a result of the hearings and the proposal to replace the four that were taken down with 18 trees, granted
so
permission to do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's a little bit from the permission to just break out by talking about something that's actually going on right now.
Yes.
Sorry, can we come back? I mean, this is something that I think is, I just started thinking about it last time. But what were the kinds of things that Lexus did to, we could talk about incentivizing certain kinds of tools.
Right.
What are the kinds of tools that we can
are so different from what you
have. Absolutely, yep.
This I like because this gives us more flexibility. Because truth be told, families have two jobs. Everyone needs a car. It's,
until we have better public transportation, I think that's where we're at.
But I'm not sure that we're particularly interested in making these places commercially attractive to development.
So, one of the things to consider is, do we want to designate areas which are going to be, or what's the balance between designating areas which would be appealing to, large-scale developers who would want to put up, 200, 300-unit buildings versus designating areas with small lots that would probably be appealing pretty much only to small-scale developers.
See this little stretch here? These houses are so close together. They all have driveways now. But if you zone them for larger units, then all of a sudden, all the trees go away on this street because everybody's going to want to park right in the front yard. That's trailer park stuff, and I know a lot about that.
I don't think it's allowed to park in the front yard.
I park in my front yard.
Yeah.
That's where my driveway is.
What's your address there?
First name only.
First name.
What, are they going to come in through the back? That's what
so, that's a worthwhile question to ask. But when you, if we included these lots in a designated area, then a new owner of the lot, or the current owner, would have to think through, could I build units that are appealing and that would have, in terms of layout of the building and size, could I put enough parking to meet demand for more than one, being more than a single family home? Now that the change in the zoning would put those things on the table. We don't have to decide those for the property owner or for future owners. What we're doing is finding areas in town where we're willing to allow property owners a little bit more freedom, a few more options as to what they do with their land.
They have that now, I would think. You could go to the select board, you go to zoning.
I gotta go check the time.
Green lights or anything.
I don't think that.
You don't think so?
No.
Wait, 8 minutes over.
We have 140.
Oh, 8 minutes later.
Of zoning.
Okay, so let's wrap up the conversation and report back, and then we're going to leave room for whole room question and answers.
Oh, what do you think?
A three-story
park.
Three-story buildings.
Ready?
It works well.
Oh, okay. So I just want to know, we're going to go around the table to each table, and if you could just generally report on the conversation based on the mishmash of stuff I gave you at the front of this breakout, okay? I'll start with you, Rich. You look like you're ready.
I'm sure there's space here for
him. All right, so the only thing we changed is the parking. In the whole Shawsheen area, we dropped it down to one spot per unit, with the idea that if you're going to live in the middle of town on the bus route and the whole purpose here is to get people taking the buses, you don't need the extra car spots. That's just a little bit of a risk, though, because they might build out all that new housing and nobody wants to live there.
I like the expression, if you build it, they will come. Developers usually have a better feel for it than we as towns planning for these places, and they're not going to build something that they don't think is viable and will get used. So, Jim, what did your table say?
Chris? Never mind. We were actually having a kind of a wide-ranging discussion, but at least a couple of us feel strong that we don't really know enough to be able to comment on this. We don't really know enough to be able to say anything, come up with anything meaningful about how you can work with height restrictions, setbacks, and parking across this whole range of properties that we've got. It's too complicated.
That's a valid answer. It is complicated, and one of the reasons we wanted to bring it up tonight was just so that you are aware, this is the conversation we're going to get down and dirty with in the next month on the planning board to figure out how to actually make the district zoning work, okay?
I think we came to that same conclusion, that there are a lot of people that have been working really hard on this and have a lot of experience. When we first sat down with the additional guidance and requests, we looked at de-densifying much in the way that Table 4 did, because we wanted that slow growth and we wanted our town systems to be able to respond to that. And I think that we have a fond respect for what you all do and the work that you're continuing to do, and we thank you for that.
Thank you, and we really appreciate your guys' help tonight here and the other groups as well. Feel free to move your dots if there was a reaction in that way, too, so it reflects what your final thoughts are.
Did anyone else read that?
So I think the only thing that we've been throwing around here, because I don't know that there's any right answer to any of this, right, but that because there's so much concern about traffic and schools, a plan that would avoid having chunks of kids come into the school system, which means avoiding 100-unit developments, right, would mean that if we rezoned North Center and South Center, effectively what we're saying is that over a longer period of time, people have the option to do a 3 or 4 family on their lot. That's going to take a decade to have really any significant impact. And so if we're really worried about things like traffic and the burden on the school system and town character and the like, rezoning North Center and South Center really begins to make those areas, to me, feel a little more like Cambridge. You know, you walk the streets of Cambridge, there's a lot of great large historic homes that have been turned into 3 families and 4 families. You know, developing the Shawsheen area is going to mean ultimately, it may not happen right away, but at some point, a builder's going to build 100 units, 200 units, and the town is going to have to deal with the implications of that. And so just something to consider, that if we looked at North Center and South Center as the rezoning locations, it might give us a more, just a smaller approach to the growth in town.
Very good point.
Yeah, very well thought out, yeah. And maintain that small town feel without, but also giving us more capacity.
Yeah, just to carry on that theme of controlled growth, something that we talked about realistically is when we were all showing our dots with the green maps, the green dots on the maps, nearly every table had this huge concentration of green at Stop and Shop Plaza. Fact is, if somebody comes in and builds a 200 or 400 unit building there, it's going to sit half filled for years. Nobody's going to build that big building there, right? Controlled growth, several pockets of smaller density building is more practically feasible for the town. No, I don't have the answer how that works, but it's the most realistic, scalable option.
Thank you. Last table, Nick.
In really trying to just focus on what the question was here, we looked at what would need to be done. We basically said, let's just more or less eliminate the parking requirements. Let them be one or whatever makes sense. Not use these really large, really large requirements for parking that would effectively make any kind of these buildings just not work. So we were okay with essentially cutting the parking more or less to one unit. I suggested like one for round up the square root of the number of bedrooms, something along that nature. With regards to the stop and shop area, we were very much in favor of the idea of taking advantage of, all right, if we're going to make that a zone, then we want to incentivize the continuing mixed use by allowing a fourth floor in that zone, at least in the areas where mixed use makes sense. And then with regards to the Loomis section, we were suggestive of right up the zoning that would allow for the classic triple deckers that everybody's familiar with to be built in that area. We know that that's going to be complex to come up with an actual rules that would work, but that would be the goal.
Very good. Thank you so much. All right. So that's our exercises. Thank you again for helping us with them and giving us your constructive input on that. Now we're going to throw it as we're at 9 o'clock, but we want to stay here as long as you want to stay here, at least 15 minutes for questions. If you, Yeah, that's a great question. She's asking about Hanscom and was that considered?
Yeah. That's political.
Yeah.
But it is, I don't know.
And those are things that...
These are disruptive questions that maybe we have to think, like things, we can't just look at things how they are right now. You have to kind of think, what are the other externalities that might influence 50?
Yeah. So
that's fair, but maybe there's other things that we're not thinking about.
No, I mean it's a good point. The hard or not satisfying answer to that question is it's controlled by the federal government and we don't have a good in to talk with them to know what their long-term thinking is or if they have any. So we need to do what we can right now for ourselves that we can control.
I apologize if I'm making you go over something that you already said. I've heard a lot tonight from people about the small town, the thought on the resources that we have now, the constraints. We've had a lot of talk over here about things we don't have, like fields and things in town. Everybody seems to want the same thing. And I feel like I hear different from the planning board. I hear more housing, more housing, more housing. I think we all agree we need to do our share, but sometimes it feels like we're trying to push growth too fast. One of my questions is why... was the Taylor Pond in Avalon, or whatever they're called, why were they not included again?
Chris went over that. It's because they're not in an easy part of town to accommodate more residents. There's not a bus to facilities in town. It's not close to the schools. They'd be spending all of their recreational dollars in a different town, because they'd be closer to Burlington and Billerica, and do we really want to do that when there's so many people in town constantly saying why can't we have a restaurant? If we put the housing in the middle of town, it will support a demand for more of those kind of establishments.
But don't we already meet then the requirements? So we're looking to slow the growth.
The other thing to think about with most all of our multifamily housing in town now is they have a component of affordability to them. True affordability. And if we zone for multifamily where we currently have affordable, big A affordable units, meaning subsidized to help people that don't have the standard income in our area, that means that those places become no longer considered for the affordable stock.
I understand what you're saying, but you're saying it's not ideal. It's within the rules, though, and it could slow the growth. So I don't hear you guys listening to us about slowing the growth,
yeah.
though.
No,
it's not ideal, but we need to slow growth and think about the resources that we have and do it thoughtfully.
All right, so... The way The other breakouts have been asking this question, and it's a valid question. And my answer to that question is, it's not out of consideration in the long term. But the thing is, like to your question you asked earlier, Corinne, that is there anybody planning our town on a larger scale? It would be really cool and a very smart thing for us to do in our next 10-year long-range plan, which we're going to start next year after we get this done, to think about how to build up an East Bedford village that would be in that area that could support a community way of life and not just apartment residential complexes. The MBTA that services that area is the 320 is the 351. It doesn't go to AOIF, which is where most people want to go to get into the city for work. Well, we only need 50 acres, so it's hard to choose which 50 acres we want. Chris, I'm going to let Chris jump in here too.
I'm really glad you brought up the 10-year planning, because what I think we really should do with this proposal is zone something that's not going to be built, and then come back in a year or two after we've had the time to do this 10-year planning, then come back and revisit this, because that's allowed. That's part of what the state has given us, is the ability we can come in with a plan that qualifies, that isn't ideal and isn't going to be built. We could zone in everything onto the Middlesex side of town, and then in 2 years, after we've done this 10-year study, after we've been able to do a study of the traffic impacts, of the school impacts, of the service impacts, all of those things where we can actually take the time to make the right decision for our town over the long term, then we can rezone it. Because we don't have to zone it now. We just have to zone to qualify now. We can change it. We can change it many times. We can change it again and again. I mean, yes, we can't always undermine what builders have come in, and we can't do it as a result of that. But we don't have to do it now. We can do it after we've had the time to plan.
But is it really that simple? I mean, once you rezone the area, you're asking the town to go through an entire process of rezoning.
Yes, I am asking the town to do it twice. Once now it's qualified, once after we've taken
but
the time.
But there's no guarantee that people won't build.
Well, we also have to think, Nick. We could actually do what you say, but actually come up after the 10-year plan with the same answer. So we could do it. I think in the short term, it's due diligence on the part of the town and the planning board to try to comply with the spirit, not just the letter of this law, because we are in a housing crunch. I appreciate that you don't want growth. But growth happens whether you want it or not. It just happens in a way that you can't control. So we can control it by defining it. And we can allow for buildings that will be occupied by first-time homeowners, by young families that are school teachers in our school systems but live right now in New Hampshire because they can't afford to live any closer to here. We can allow for downsizers who are 30% of our population in the next year or so that want, and they all say they want to stay in town, but they don't want to live in their 4,000 square foot house. They want to live in a single floor living and in a smaller place for a cheaper price so that it can pay for the rest of their existence. We need to have those kind of opportunities. So it's market rate affordability. That's true. We're talking market rate affordability, but the idea. Yeah. I looked today. A two unit on in Avalon is like $4,000. But the idea is that if you allow more market rate housing over 177 communities, you're gonna be able to level the playing field just a bit so that that will deflate the prices a little bit so that that missing middle, the middle income worker, the younger families can be able to exist in suburbs that they're not able to get into today.
Would someone from the board, correct me if I'm wrong, but I know times have changed. A few years ago, the town voted to restrict any more multifamily housing east of Route 3. Is that, am I remembering that correctly? Planning staff?
That was before my time.
I'm sorry, Catherine? Okay, thank you. But so we have these aspirations for this housing to be affordable for first-time homeowners or teachers in town. Has there been any discussion about what the price points are going to be for, you know, homes or condos or even rental units?
Like I said, we can't really predict because their market is the market is dictating the.
What's the market rate? 800 square foot, 1,000 square foot, condo. These are questions you're going to ask.
$500,000.
That,
it's more affordable than a $2 million house that's the only thing on the market now in Bedford. And we're talking about people in Chris's slides, at the beginning of his slide deck, he went through some of the economics of the region and the fact that we're in a place in our economy regionally where we have dual income white-collar workers, you know, doing software jobs, lab jobs, that are living in apartments because they can't afford the down payments for the housing stock that is what is a, is what exists today in our region. We need to find there's a whole and if we find housing possibilities for those folks at the $1 million level instead of the $2 million level or at the $800,000 level instead of higher up, that makes more room at the apartment level for the apartment prices to go down for people that have less, even less means, single family incomes or you know not such fortunate jobs to be able to live in those places. It's a whole tiered process. Robin.
What happens if this isn't approved at town meeting? Once you come up with a plan, and what happens if it isn't approved at town meeting?
I'd like to speak to that.
Okay, Chris.
So a couple of things. First, if it didn't pass at annual town meeting, then you got the rest of the year to make it happen, so you could have we could have a second bite at the apple. But imagining that the town meeting didn't pass it, you know, any time next year. The Attorney General has indicated that that will be subject to, that any community that doesn't pass it will be subject to a civil lawsuit. There's potential to be in violation of state and federal fair housing. We'll actually open yourself up to lawsuits as well. There's a bill circulating in the legislature. It doesn't apply, as best I can tell, to MBTA adjacent communities, but for the other flavors of MBTA communities, if this bill were to pass and if those communities were to not pass the required zoning amendments, then the state would decide for them. Basically, any area within a half mile of their transit station, then whatever barriers they had in their zoning codes to prevent multifamily would be null and void. So you could imagine a legislative solution along those lines. Another possibility is a developer could come in and with a multifamily housing proposal and get their proposal rejected and then sue town because we're not in compliance with state law. Nancy.
Can you hear me with this? Yes. I'm actually probably not with a lot of the people here in the sense that I don't think we need to slow down growth. We don't have places for people to live. I have a kid who's graduating college this year. There's no way she's going to be able to afford an apartment in the Boston area, period. Maybe a room in an apartment with several other people, maybe. If we have more units, it's going to bring the costs down a bit. Because if you have more supply, then the demand's not going to be so high and they can't keep jacking up the prices. I think we need to have more places for people to live in town. and we are going to have a big turnover in the next 30, 40 years. We are a very old community, and we're going to see people not being able to stay in their homes because they're not a single floor home, and we want to have them staying in Bedford. So having these apartments available for people, or living spaces where it's one floor living, hopefully with an elevator, it would be more beneficial for people who are currently in town, because they could still be in town and have a place to stay, and maybe then a young family could move and buy their house. It's just, I don't see the need to slow things. It kind of feels like it's defeating the whole purpose of doing this. And I think the whole area needs more housing. And if you don't see that, we can't block off Bedford and say, oh no, we don't want people here. It's gonna happen.
Yes, for what it's worth, there is a bill in the legislature which would extend the multifamily zoning law to the rest of the state.
Right.
I wanted to pick up on something from table six. I think when it comes to the town meeting and you have to sell this plan, I think things like having the housing available so that our kids can stay here, having the housing available so that our seniors can go from a big house to a small house. I think if we focus on more of that and less of the state demands that you do this, I think it might sell a little easier.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Oh, go ahead, Amy.
So I agreed with what you were saying, because I had thought that at the same time that, now I can't remember, my brain went blank. That we don't have to tomorrow or the day that we have the town meeting, we don't have to all of a sudden have all these living places for everybody. It can, in the state, that's not fair to do that to us, to say that you're going to be sued if we can't produce stuff right away. And also, builders aren't going to build affordable housing, no matter how hard. You know, we had a big development go across the street from our house. They're not going to build affordable housing because it's not worth it to them to do it. So what we need to do is have incentives. Like if somebody sells their house, a big house or whatever, they have incentive to turn it into several units. Or instead of, because they're not going to do it. They're not going to build. They're going to keep building the big mansions because that's where they get the money from.
I think there's a case that developers will eventually pick up on the multifamily options, but there's going to be some lag time.
So let me just speak to, and then you had a comment. So this, the multifamily zoning law has no production requirements associated with it. It's only to allow housing to be built. So we wouldn't be sued over no units being built. It would only be if we didn't allow units to be built in 50 acres in town. You had another point that I was going to respond to, but I forget what I was going to say, so I'm going to hand it over here.
Is there a possibility that before the town meeting for us to do again, do something like this, and for you to carve out a Middlesex Turnpike option? Can we get 50 acres of Middlesex Turnpike that would take some of the heat off of the Stop and Shop area?
So we, as a board, we discussed it at our November 14th meeting. I came up with the reasons stated before and took it off the table, raised it again at the 28th, at our meeting on the 28th. No one had an interest in reconsidering, so Middlesex Turnpike is off the table.
Hold on. So if we do, then we're going to have to vote down the meeting at the March meeting and basically tell the planning board to do better and come back in.
Are we doing that now? What are you presenting?
What we're trying to tell them now.
If you could present an amendment to town meeting.
You can't really present an amendment to a town meeting on a 50 page zoning law. The lawyer will just laugh it out.
Well, you can. So. We have public our meetings are on Zoom. Anybody can come, and Nick knows we listen to people that show up. So you can come and talk to us about it in our next couple of meetings. No, I have to take offense a little bit about how you're characterizing the planning board. We're not trying to shove housing down anybody's throat. We're just trying to comply with the law so that this town isn't sued. And we've been listening to not just you folks tonight, but to everybody that we hear from. And as many people we hear from tonight are saying, do Middlesex. We've heard that number or more that say, don't do Middlesex. So, I mean, we're trying to listen, and we are trying to represent you as our elected officials that you voted for to do what you're asking. But we're hearing both sides of it, and you did elect us and put some faith in us to do that and make a decision on how to do it. And
we also filled out a survey where roughly half the town said Middlesex.
Yeah. So there's also something we didn't really talk about in this. It's called it's called best practices for creating communities that people love and want to live in, and putting them on a highway like situation on the Middlesex Turnpike, with no amenities, and it is not conducive to a great community or residential feel. So. That's why, as a planning board, we've concentrated on the center of town, where if we could amp up a little bit more density in the middle of town, we'd be able to support a lot more activities like people want. Like somebody said, they want to see town center be more alive, like Lexington or Concord, right? We don't have enough housing, enough people in the middle of our town to do that right now. So if we use this opportunity, perhaps we would. Yeah, this isn't. No, actually, it's got a highway now. But is there a sewer capacity to for 750 more units? No, we'd have to have funding for that to support. They're doing it for the lab tech spaces specifically, and the lab tech spaces take a lot of water consumption. And so, if we're going to do additional residential units, we need to think about another sewer plan for that.
Wanted to be close to amenities and have walkability and everything else. People I know prefer to live out in the outskirts of town. They want a big backyard. They want land. They want the quiet that comes with so many people here tonight said, why did you move to Bedford? Small town community feel. Not because it was a land of apartment buildings and it doesn't feel like Somerville, for lack of a better term. Like Somerville, that's just the city that comes to mind. I think we do have to slow growth. I think we do have to look at, we didn't put the fire station on North Road. One of the reasons that we were kept being told was because of the traffic in that area, yet we want to throw more housing in that same area. So I think from my perspective anyway, and people can disagree all day, you know, that's why we're here. There's a lot of conflicting information with what we're being told and how our opinions and perspectives are being perceived, I think.
There's a lot of different inputs and a lot of different factors to take into consideration. One of the things that we need to think about, too, is, in an earlier slide deck, when I was talking with, one of the boards or committees I've been talking to, we have, 5,000 acres in town or something like that, and we have 12,000 people. It comes out to like 1.2 people per acre or something. And in Lexington, the number of people per acre is like 3. So, you know, it's like, it's how are you measuring it, too? It's like, by that metric, it doesn't seem like a very, like there's a lot of a problem. I don't know.
So my recollection of what Lexington did is far less than perfect, so take what I say with a grain of salt. But my memory of their map is they spread out their zones all over town. Not necessarily all over, but along the Mass Ave and major routes. And they allowed for more height near town center. I like that suggestion. Same time, Lexington's only a few months ahead of us. So, they haven't. We're not going to see how any of this is going to play out for a while yet. The idea is that if we lower the barriers to multifamily housing being built, then people who come in and have the money to pay market rate for housing, we'll move in there rather than bidding up the price of more affordable housing. If we let law of supply and demand work, then hopefully that works in favor of keeping some of the more affordable, lowercase a, affordable units in town affordable. Yes.
So have you had a lot of conversations with other communities about this, or are we just kind of, like, I just kind of see this, that are they embracing this, or are people feeling that this is being shoved down our throats? Because my question is, have you heard any, like, I would see this as like a bunch of communities getting together and fighting back with the state about this and saying, you can't force us to do this.
Lexington passed this by a pretty wide margin back in April or May. Arlington passed by a huge margin back about a month and a half ago. Brookline passed it by a huge margin, and it's like 80-20, 90-10 margin.
Newton just did theirs.
Yeah, Newton just did theirs like a couple of days ago. The only community that I can think of that didn't pass it was Littleton.
And but
they could let it ride and see what the state does.
We're talking to other communities. The planning staff is in a cohort with other communities our size to think about discussing how they're doing it mutually. We're trying to look to each other to find best practices and how to do it. Carlisle has to comply.
I don't think they've voted yet.
They probably haven't voted yet. So the towns that have those transit facilities in them are the ones that have to have their zoning done by the end of this year. That's the votes that you're hearing about in the news and the Globe and all that kind of stuff right now. There's a dozen or so communities that have to get it done by the end of this month. Most all the rest of them, like us, need to comply by the end of next year. We have to like start thinking about it earlier because we have the earliest town meeting in the state, I think, or something like that, somebody said. So we have to have this figured out really soon to get it to town meeting for 24. I think everybody need to embrace it. It's not a bad thing. I think there's room for it in every community, and if all the communities do it, it's spread out. It's going to help everybody's bottom line.
And give more opportunities. It's not that there haven't been concerns, but they've hashed them out, and that's what we're working for here.
Yeah. So. No, but we're pointing to those examples because they had to do them earlier. But all of our neighbors, 177, all of the Franklins, all of the Westwoods of this world that are all comparable size to us in locations on the Beltway around the state, the metro area, they all have to do it. But in this next year, so we're all kind of having these conversations one-on-one in our conversations like we are tonight. Everybody's doing it in their own towns trying to figure it out. No, but they still have to comply. Yeah. Yeah.
And Concord. I just asked...
Right.
I just asked Tony Fields, who's in our cohort where we're having discussions, and it's Burlington, Billerica, Drakett, and Maynard.
Yeah. So it's way past our time. We really appreciate you coming and asking all these great questions and giving us input. We're listening. We really are. And we're going to try our best to make everybody, as many people, as happy as possible in this and come to town meeting with something that you all... we'll be able to hopefully vote in support of.